But why?
You're still thinking about it?
Why did he come to Copenhagen?
Well, does it matter, my love? Now we're all three of us dead and gone.
Some questions remain long after their owners have died, lingering like ghosts, looking for the answers they never found in life.
Some questions have no answers to find.
Why did he come? What was he trying to tell you?
He did explain later.
He explained over and over again. Each time he explained, it became more obscure.
It was probably very simple when you come right down to it. He wanted to have a talk.
A talk? To the enemy? In the middle of a war?
Margretta, my love, we were scarcely the enemy.
It was 1941.
Heisenberg was one of our oldest friends.
Heisenberg was German. We were Danes. We were under German occupation.
It put us in a difficult position, certainly.
I've never seen you as angry with anyone as you were with Heisenberg that night.
Not to disagree, but I believe I remained remarkably calm.
I know when you're angry.
It was as difficult for him as it was for us.
So why did he do it? Now no one can be hurt. Now no one can be betrayed.
I doubt if he ever really knew himself.
And he wasn't a friend, not after that visit. That was the end of the famous friendship between Niels Bohr and Werner Heisenberg.
Now we're all dead and gone, yes. And there are only two things the world remembers about me. One is the uncertainty principle, and the other is my mysterious visit to Niels Bohr in Copenhagen in 1941. Everyone understands uncertainty, or thinks he does. No one understands my trip to Copenhagen. Time and time again I've explained it to Bohr himself and Margrethe, to interrogators and intelligence officers, to journalists and historians. The more I've explained, the deeper the uncertainty has become. Well, I shall be happy to make one more attempt. Now we're all dead and gone. Now no one can be hurt. Now no one can be betrayed.
I never entirely liked him, you know. Perhaps I can say that to you now.
Oh, yes, you did. When he was first here in the 20s, of course you did. On the beach at Tisvila with us and the boys, he was one of the family.
Something alien about him even then.
So quick and eager.
Too quick, too eager.
Those bright, watchful eyes.
Too bright, too watchful.
Well, he was a very great physicist. I've never changed my mind about that.
They were all good, all the people who came to Copenhagen to work with you. You had most of the great pioneers in atomic theory here at one time or another.
And the more I look back on it, the more I think that Heisenberg was the greatest of them all.
So what was Bohr? He was the first of us all, the father of us all. Modern atomic physics began when Bohr realized the quantum theory applied to matter as well as to energy. 1913. Everything we did was based on that great insight of his.
And you think that he first came here to work with me in 1924?
I'd only just finished my doctorate, and Bohr was the most famous atomic physicist in the world.
And in just over a year, he'd invented quantum mechanics.
Came out of his work with you.
Mostly out of what he'd been doing with Max Born and Pascual Jordan at Göttingen. And in another year or so, he'd got uncertainty.
And you'd done complementarity.
We argued them both out together.
We did most of our best work together.
Heisenberg usually led the way.
Bohr made sense of it all.
We operated like a business.
Chairman and managing director.
Father and son.
A family business.
Even though we had sons of our own.
And we went on working together long after he ceased to be my assistant.
Long after I'd left Copenhagen in 1927 and gone back to Germany. Long after I had a chair and a family of my own.
Then the Nazis came to power.
And it got more and more difficult. When the war broke out, impossible. Until that day in 1941.
When it finished forever.
Yes. Why did he do it?
September 1941. For years, I had it down in my memory as October.
September, the end of September.
A curious sort of diary memory is.
You open the pages and all the neat headings and tidy jottings dissolve around you.
You step through the pages into the months and days themselves.
The past becomes the present inside your head.